Hello everyone, my name is Emdy and welcome to episode 2 of my practical redstone series. In this video, we will be looking at these blocks, repeaters, observers, and comparators. Like in the last video, this is what they look like in vanilla, but because of texture packs, in this video you will see them like this. First up, the repeater. A repeater can be placed on the top of blocks and has four main sides, an input in the back, and an output in the front. There are also two additional inputs on the sides. All these inputs are based on the direction of the repeater, determined by where you are looking when you place it. You can identify the direction by looking at this triangle shape, or noting the place of the torch piece here that isn't on the red track. A repeater serves many purposes. It can be used to extend the range of redstone signals, delay the output of a signal, or lock a favorable output. A repeater will get activated if its input, the side of the block, is facing a powered block. When this happens, it powers the block its output faces into, being this block here. This extension of power is not instant. By default, a repeater has 2 game ticks of delay from input to output. This delay of a repeater can be changed to 4, 6, and 8 game ticks by right-clicking it. These 4 delays are shown by the position change of the torch in the track. One property to note is that if the pulse into a repeater is shorter than the delay it is currently set to, the pulse length of the output will actually be equivalent to the delay the repeater is set to. For example, if I give a 2 game tick pulse using a torch and redstone block into this 8 game tick delay repeater, the output pulse would come 8 game ticks later and stay on for 8 game ticks instead of 2. But if, for example, you have a 12 game tick pulse in an 8 game tick repeater, the output is still 12 game ticks long with no extension to it, but simply an 8 game tick delay between input and output. The last feature of a repeater is locking. When a repeater is powered from either side by either another repeater or a comparator, its current output is locked instantly and cannot be changed till the power is removed. Locking is shown by a bedrock bar in place of the torch piece. Now a more complex component, the comparator. There are countless videos explaining the comparator alone, so this may seem a bit repetitive to all of you. The comparator is similar to the repeater in the way it is placed and also the kinds of sides it has. One main input, one output, and 2 side inputs. The output side is the one with a singular torch, while the input is the one with 2. Like a repeater, a comparator has a delay of 2 game ticks between input and output. However, unlike a repeater, this delay cannot be changed. Comparators are used to detect and measure changes in fill levels of containers, compare 2 or 3 different signals, and perform subtraction operations of 2 signals. We'll start with the comparison feature. This is the mode of the comparator by default. What it does is check whether the power level of the input from the back is greater than those of the sides, giving the value of the main input straight to the output if it is greater, and giving no output if it is lesser. If there is no side input, then the power level that goes into the comparator is the same as what comes out of the output. This can be used along with a natural delay to make what are known as comparator fade-out timers or clocks. These circuits involve a loop of comparators where there is a single decrease in power level every loop, causing a slow decay of power depending on the amount of comparators in the loop. If there was no fade point, it would form a memory cell where the inputted power level is stored and can be accessed or manipulated if needed. Note, this power level is maintained through conductive blocks, so setups like these still work as expected. Moving on to the subtraction feature, enabled by right-clicking the comparator so that the forward torch knob turns on. When in subtract mode, the comparator subtracts the side inputs from the main input, as you can see here. These inputs can be direct or through dust, where the output values are always calculated and outputted as power levels, meaning that precise subtraction of the number of items in a container is not possible. Speaking of which, we move on to container measurement, arguably one of the most useful features of a comparator. A comparator can read the fill level or state of a container placed in front of its input, either directly or through a solid block. This includes all of these blocks here, as well as item frames which have a unique interaction. For storage blocks that have user interfaces, the power the comparator outputs is calculated very interestingly. Massive thanks to Lolo for code digging and checking this for me. I'll quickly explain the code, not that it's something you have to remember, but I found it interesting. This part selects each slot of the container in sequence. This checks if the slot is empty, and if it is not, it runs this, which is basically dividing the number of items in the slot by the maximum size that item can stack to. It adds all of these values up and divides it by the total number of slots in the container, then multiplies it by 14 and rounds down to get it in a power level range. Finally, if the container is not empty, it adds 1 to the value, and that is your final power level. In simple terms, thank you to Saint Dragon for this, it takes the average of the fraction of fullness for every slot in the container, multiplies it by 14 and rounds down, then adds 1 if the container is not empty. What's important to note is that it measures each slot as a fraction of its maximum stack size. So one non-stackable item is equivalent to a full 64 stack for most items, or a full 16 stack for things that stack to 16. One of a 16 stackable item is equivalent to 4 of a 64 stackable item. For other containers such as composters and cauldrons, the output is one of the total number of possible levels depending on how many fill levels that container can have. For example, in a composter, each layer you fill increases the power by 1 to a maximum of 7, which then momentarily turns to 8 when the bone meal is formed. For cauldrons, it is usually values from 1 to 3, with lava being the exception, having only 1 level and outputting power 3. Cake is also an interesting block. A full cake will be read as 14 power, with each eaten slice decreasing the power level by 2. Item frames have a unique interaction with comparators no other entity has. When on the opposite side of a block a comparator is reading, the comparator can check the tilt of the item through 8 possible values. Other miscellaneous blocks include end portal frames, giving 15 power when they have an eye, and 0 otherwise. Command blocks give an output when a command is executed successfully. I won't be covering command blocks, but there is a really good ongoing command series by SliceLime that does cover it. Jukeboxes give a power level depending on the disk being played. Refer to the wiki for each value. Comparators reading lecterns use a different formula to get their power level, being this one here. 14 times 1 less than the page number, upon 1 less than the total page count. Then add 1 and round down. So a 15 page book on page 12 gives power 12, but a 20 page book on page 12 gives power 9. Respawn anchors give powers 3, 7, 11, and 15 depending on the charge level. The last exception is Skulk, but that is much too complicated to cover here. I'll link another video by SliceLime in the cards and description. A neat property of comparators that's used in things like storage tech is the reading priority. If a comparator has a container it can read through a block, it will prioritize reading the level of the container instead of whatever power may run into the block. This changes only when the block is powered with full power 15, in which case the comparator reads it and outputs power 15. Before I move on, there are a couple of advanced uses of comparators you may see in some contraptions, but may not be very obvious to understand. When a comparator measures the level of a container, there is no real limit to the value it can output. So theoretically, if you fill a container beyond its regular maximum capacity, a comparator would output a value higher than 15. This is actually possible to do in vanilla Minecraft using overstacked items, such as double cursed books made with a grindstone. This greater power level transfers perfectly through a comparator normally, because all it does is take the input level and directly output it. You can, however, also perform subtraction on this greater power, and it works as you would expect. So power 5 subtracted from power 17 gives an output of 12. The other component that reacts to power of different levels is redstone dust. But sadly, dust has a hard limit of power 15. So no matter the power you input, dust will always limit it to a maximum of 15. Another useful feature is what are called comparator update detectors, or CUDs. What are comparator updates, you may ask? In Minecraft, the way blocks communicate changes is through a system of updates. These updates originate from a source and let surrounding blocks know that a change has happened. There are four main kinds of updates: shape updates, also called state updates, block updates or neighbor change updates, comparator updates, which are a kind of subset of block updates, and finally light updates. I'll cover shape updates in a bit, and light updates aren't too important for now. Block updates are given out in a variety of situations, but most commonly when components get powered. In the blocks I've shown so far, updates are sent to all the places where the blocks could get activated and denoted by glass and concrete. Comparator updates are a subset of block updates which only affect comparators. They are given off by containers when something about their contents change or there is some interaction with their GUI. These updates move in a plus shape and only horizontal, unlike block updates which can move in all directions. They first go to the four blocks around the container, and if it's a conductive block, it goes one further in the same direction to update potential comparators. Breaking a regular block sends updates only to the immediate blocks. So breaking this detector rail won't update the comparator, and it is said to be budded for a block update detector. A change to this hopper, for example, even just clicking a slot in the GUI, will send comparator updates, and the comparator then turns off. This can be automated using pistons and has a few cool uses. I'll leave links to a few cool applications of them, as well as overstacking, in the description. We finally move to the observer, which doesn't have as much to it. The observer has two main sides, an input face denoted by the face-like texture, and an output face denoted by this dot. Observers can be placed in any direction, including upwards and downwards, and when placing them, the output faces you by default. An observer has a 2 game tick delay between detection and output, and its output is always a 2 game tick pulse. What do I mean by detect? Observers react to what are called shape or state updates. These are changes in the states of blocks that you can see with targeted block information in the F3 debug screen. There is only one exception to this rule, and that is detecting the opening and closing of shulkers. Any change in any of these values can be detected by an observer. It is important to note that shape updates and block updates are not the same. Using a block update detector, which I will explain in a future video, you can see that shape updates given off by blocks like trapdoors and fence gates can only be detected by observers, while updates given by repeaters powering can be detected by buds. There are also changes that give off both updates and can be detected by both observers and buds, such as placing and breaking blocks. I think that's enough for this video, but like before, there's some homework. Number 1, monostable circuits. Using the blocks from last episode and this one, make a circuit that outputs a 2 game tick pulse when a lever like this turns on, and another circuit for when it turns on as well as off. For an extra challenge, try to do the second one without observers. Press counter. Make a system that needs a stone button to be pressed 3 consecutive times without a gap to give an output. Counter. Design a system that can count up and down from 0 to 15, with inputs to add or subtract 1. Store the value as well as output it. To help with addition, this formula may be helpful to you. That marks the end of the video. Thanks for watching this episode. Please share your challenge attempts on the NubTech Discord server in the submissions channel, and make sure to spoiler tag them so people attempting don't accidentally see it before trying. And as always, I hope you learned something from this. Feedback over on Discord is very welcome and really appreciated. Any difficulties with the challenge can also be asked in the Discord in the relevant channel. Leave a like and comment if you found this video useful, share it with others so they can learn too, and I'll see you in episode 3, which should hopefully come sooner than this one did. Bye!